Thank you. Thank you all for coming. I want to thank Mount Sinai and the World Trade Center Health Program for sponsoring this and two other forums we had earlier in the week on Monday. And we are really pleased at this showing and all of you showing up. If any of you have any questions that at the end are personal questions, Fran Godfrey, the director of the New York Office of the Victims Compensation Fund, and myself will stay around until the last questions are answered. So if you don't want your questions answered in public, we will hang around as long as necessary to answer your questions. It's a great privilege for me to have been appointed by the Attorney General to administer this fund. As you know, Congress passed the Zadroger Act to provide compensation for those who have been injured as a result of the 9/11 catastrophe. And we have been working very hard with many of your lawyers and many of you personally to get this moving in a way that is going to put money in the pockets of those of you who have been injured. And you have been very patient. It's 10 years, but we're sort of new at this, even though you have waited for 10 years since the incident occurred. So what we'd like to do tonight is take you through some of the points that you should know in order to file a claim with the Victims Compensation Fund, and then we'll answer all of your questions as best we can. Now, let me make very clear to you something that is coming up, and that's why we're anxious to get the message out as wide as possible, and that is, there is going to be an October 3rd deadline. The October 3rd deadline requires that a claimant, any of you who have a claim, have to register with the Victims Compensation Fund. This was set up by Congress when Congress provided for this money. The fund is in existence for 5 years. But if you have an injury, and that injury arose prior to the time the fund was originated, and we're going to show you what those dates are, then you have to register by October 3rd of this year in order to be included in the fund. You don't have to file your whole form. You don't have to file your eligibility form or your compensation form, but you have to be registered. And we're going to show you what that means and how it gets done. And we have as many facilities as we can to help you. There's a website. You can go on the Victims Compensation Fund website. It is vcf.gov, G-O-V. That's where you'll find all of the information you need to fill out a form online. That it's a very simple form, the registration form. There's a much longer form for eligibility and compensation. And some of you may need a lawyer to do that. And you shouldn't hesitate to try to find a lawyer. Congress has provided that lawyers can only get 10% of what you get. So they can't get 33 1/3%. Well, what they would usually get in a personal injury case, they can only recover from you 10%. So if you think you're going to have trouble filling out these forms, or you have trouble getting the information you think you need, go out and get a lawyer. We can't recommend lawyers to you, but there are lots of lawyers that are advertising and are taking claims. So don't hesitate if you think you need one. There's a limited amount that lawyer can charge you, and that's provided by the statute. So that, I think, is very important for you to understand. And these dates are important, and we're going to go over them with you in various ways so you know exactly when and what you have to file. So let us take you through some of this information, and we're going to try to make it as clear as possible, and then we're going to respond to all of your questions that we can. We're dealing here with a statute that was passed by Congress, and it's called the Zadroger Act. And there are two pieces to this act. One is a medical provision that provides for treatment for certain injuries that have been presumed to have arisen out of the World Trade Center incident. And the other is the compensation feature, which we're going to talk about today. So let me just ask this question. How many of you are under treatment in the World Trade Center health program? That's great. Okay. And you're going to see that puts you in a very good position, because we are looking to that program, the World Trade Center health program, to help us determine who has the kinds of injury that is accepted in the program and who has those injuries that have substantially deemed to be caused by 9/11. So those of you who are in the program, that's going to be very helpful, as you're going to see, because we have an arrangement with the National Institute of Safety and Health that runs the program, and that relationship allows us to get information directly from them about your conditions. And what we've tried to do is try to create relationships with various groups that are important in the World Trade Center Health Program, so that you don't have to give us that information. We can go and get it directly. This is to make it easier for you to apply. So when you apply and you tell us you're being treated under the World Trade Center Health Program, we get that information directly from them, and they will certify you if you are in the program, and that puts you into our program. And that's a big step up, as we will show you. Okay. Let me just talk a little about the purpose of the Victims Compensation Fund. This is what we call a no-fault program. You don't have to prove anybody was at fault, as you would have to do if you had a lawsuit. If you fit within the criteria that Congress provided, you will be compensated under this program without having to show anything that goes back to the negligence of any party. So what do we provide compensation for? There are two parts. One is economic loss, and one is non-economic loss. By economic loss, the statute means, did you lose any wages? If you are out sick as a result of the condition that you are claiming under, you will get what we call compensation, which will be those lost wages. If you have out-of-pocket expenses for medications or for doctors, you give us those bills, you'll get compensated for those losses. That's what we call economic loss. And Fran is going to take you through all of those pieces, but I just want to give you an overview. And if you have losses for services that you have to get someone else to do, you can't mow your lawn because you have asthma, you can get compensation for the person you had to pay to mow your lawn. So this is what we mean by economic loss. You lost money out of your pocket, and this fund will replace that. And then you can also recover for non-economic loss, and that would be the equivalent of your pain and suffering. And that, to some extent, is going to depend on the extent of your disability, on the extent of your injury. And so we have certain categories that people will get certain amounts of money based on their level of disability, which would be the equivalent of this non-economic loss. So how does this compare? If you remember, after the 9/11 catastrophe. There was a victims' compensation fund, and it compensated a lot of people who were in the airplanes and had died, and on the ground who had died, and people who had been injured. And we now call that Victims' Compensation Fund 1, because that was the original one. And it was a very limited fund. It was very limited to the, you had to be in almost the four corners of the World Trade Center in order to recover. There was a very short time period that you had to be there in order to recover, and the types of injuries were limited as well. What this new fund does is it expands the area that you have to be in order to recover. It expands the injuries that you have that can allow you to be recovering, and it also expands the time period. If you were there any time between September 11th, 2001, and May 30th, 2002, you now can come under this fund. And we'll show you the injuries that you can recover for, which are deemed to be World Trade Center, Health Center injuries, like asthma, like GERDs, like the kinds of injuries you're being treated for here in Mount Sinai or at Bellevue or at any of the other centers where you may be seeking treatment. But there is a requirement, and those injuries or conditions must be as a result of the crashes or debris removal. And you have to understand, when we ask you for the information we're asking you, we're really required to do that because Congress has provided for all the things you're going to see. You have to establish that you were present at the World Trade Center site or the geographic area that has now been included as the World Trade Center site. You have to establish that you have an injury, and that injury is one of the injuries that is recognized as being an injury that is substantially related as a result of the crash or the debris removal. So we need to ask you in the application information that we can get so that we can make those conclusions. And sometimes we have to go back and ask you questions after we get the application, or ask your lawyer questions, so that we can make sure that we've met what Congress has required of us in order to give you the money. So when our people call you for information, they're trying to help you get the information you need so that you can get compensation under this fund. And what we've tried to do is for certain employers and certain unions where we can get information directly from the employers, like the fire department and the police department, we don't bother you. We go directly to them and get that information. Social Security information we get from the Social Security Department. Pension information we get from the city pension funds. So we have tried to do everything we can to make it easier for you to apply and for us to get the information directly from the source, so you don't have to get the information from the source. And we'll show you some of those things when we get to them. So we have a large plaintiff, a potential claimant pool, because it's an expanded area, an expanded time period, an expanded injuries, as you're going to see. And as many of you know, in the beginning, various cancers were not included as World Trade Center health-related injuries that would be compensable. Those have been added. We're going to talk about them. It's a very important change in the kinds of injuries that we can compensate for now. And for many of you, I think this is going to be a very important change as to the kind of compensation you're going to be able to get. So let's look at the eligibility. As I said, there are three parts three parts to what you have to file a claim for. One is this registration. Registration is very simple. All we want to do is have your name, social security number, address, email address, and some very, very basic information. Were you a first responder? Did you come in as a construction worker? Were you a maintenance worker? Did you reside in the area? Did you work in the area? Very basic information, very easy to fill out. You can do that part without a lawyer. That's going to be what you have to do in order to start the process, okay? And that's what's going to be very important for you to stop the running, we'd call it a statute of limitations, but to get on file before October 3rd. It's just the registration piece you have to do. You will have till 2016, October 2016, to complete the process. You can do the process as quickly or as slowly as you want. It's not going to affect the amount of money you get, but you have to register. That's essential, it's important, and if you had an injury that goes back at least 2 years, you've been diagnosed up to 2 years before, you have to now file, okay? We're gonna keep saying that because it's very important. We don't want people to be left out who should be there and should be getting compensation, okay? But you also have to fill out two other parts of the form. One is eligibility, to show that you fit in to the requirements of the statute. And the third part is compensation. You have to tell us how you lost economic loss, if you have a loss of wages, doctor bills that you had to pay out of pocket, medical costs, drug costs that you had to pay out of pocket. That's the compensation part. So you can fill it all out at once. You can fill it out in parts. You can wait until we find you eligible to fill out the compensation form. But my recommendation, fill it out as quickly as you can to get not only on file, but so that we can begin the process of reviewing your forms and get you through the system. So, and if you need, as I said, help from lawyers, you should get it. So what do you have to establish? You were present at the 9/11 crash site. And that's where I assume most of you, this also applies to the Pentagon and Shanksville, but I assume most of you were involved in the World Trade Center. And you had to be present at any point from September 11th, 2001 to May 30th, 2002. And you had to timely withdraw. If you had a lawsuit, you had to timely withdraw or settle that lawsuit and or dismiss that lawsuit. And that's where sometimes a lawyer would be helpful to you. And you have to have a diagnosis of a qualified injury or condition that is determined to be the result of the attacks or debris removal. Now, if you have been certified under the World Trade Center Health Program, that means that they have already found that you have an injury that is a result of the 9/11 attacks. So that gives you a real advantage in this program. You have met that requirement. You're still going to have to show that you were present at the site, and we're going to talk about that in a minute, because to get into the World Trade Center Health Program, we have different rules than they have to get into that program. But you do get past this, almost the end of the last hurdle here, you have a diagnosis of a qualified injury that has been found by the World Trade Center Health Program to be a result of the 9/11 attacks, okay? And we'll be happy to answer questions on that in the question and answer period. So what do we mean by present at the 9/11 crash site? Well, you don't really have to be there on 9/11. No, that's not, it's a much broader requirement. If you were there in the aftermath as part of the construction crew or the maintenance crew, and it was any time between the periods of September 11th, 2001 and May 30th, 2002, you are present. Or if you were within what we call the New York City exposure zone, you are present. And we're going to show you what you're going to have to establish to show that presence. And that area is anything south of Canal Street, from river to river. So if you resided there, if you worked there, it's a pretty large area, includes Chinatown, includes the Lower East Side, includes the financial district, and any areas along the debris route, such as where the barges were or the Fresh Kills landfill, Phil, you may be able to establish presence at the site. And that's going to change and vary from claimant to claimant. And in some instances, if you are a fireman or a policeman, it's going to be very relatively easy to establish because the fire department has all of those records and will give it to us. If you work for a union in the construction trades, we have on our website all of the varied evidence we will take to show presence. And if you can't show presence from any of those, like a pay stub or anything like that, then you can do it by way of affidavit. And for that, you may need a lawyer, and if that's the case, you should get one. You shouldn't hesitate. If you can't prove it through the various documentary proofs that are acceptable, we will still take affidavits, two affidavits of people who knew you there, saw you there, who worked in your same workplace, work site, etc. I don't think you should worry so much about this. I don't know how many of you had lawsuits that were pending. A lot of the firemen and policemen had lawsuits. There is a requirement under the statute that you have to prove that those lawsuits you've withdrawn from and that you withdrew from them before January 2, 2012. I should tell you that's not a problem. For us, we can check that for you. We ask you on the application if you had a lawsuit, if you don't know if you withdrew or not. We check that and we can find that out for you. Or if you had a lawyer in those lawsuits, which you did, that lawyer can tell you whether you withdrew during the proper time or whether the case was settled. Now this is important. These are the injuries that you can recover for. And most of these that you see here are injuries that are of the respiratory system or of the gastric system or traumatic injuries if you worked in the work site and you injured a foot, a back, or what have you. But most of these are the kinds of injuries that you're being treated for here at Mount Sinai. It's asthma, it's RADS, it's COPD, it's chronic cough syndrome, it's laryngitis, it's GERD, and some of the others that you see there. In addition, in June 8th of 2012, NIOSH proposed a new rule that certain cancers would be considered to be related to the World Trade Center exposure. And these are the cancers that have been added to the program. So if you have these cancers, that doesn't mean you will automatically be able to recover. It means that if you meet other criteria, which have been set forth by NIOSH, which is the National Institute of Safety and Health, as I said, that runs the World Trade Center program, you may be eligible to recover for your economic and non-economic loss for these injuries. And there are a number of injuries that I think you'll see. These are cancers of the respiratory system, cancers of the gastric system, the urinary system, neoplasms of the eye and the orbit of the eye. It includes blood and lymph, certain of the blood and lymphoid tissue cancers, and some childhood cancers, etc. Now, this date is important. Since this was added on October 12, 2012, you could not file before that, and you have 2 years from that date to file for a cancer. So you have till October 12, 2014 to file. This is the one area that you don't have to worry about this October 3rd deadline, because cancers were added later, and you have 2 years from the time the cancers was added in order for you to file with the VCF. As I said, the first step, of course, is to have a cancer that is defined in the program. There may be extraordinary circumstances where certain rare cancers may be covered that are not listed. So because you have a cancer that's not listed doesn't mean you shouldn't apply. We have some discretion, and we will look at those as well. And there's another requirement. You have to have been treated by a medical professional within a reasonable time of discovering that you have that injury. But I don't think with cancer that's going to be a problem for almost anybody. So this is two instances. I've mentioned this before, but I want to mention it again. As we said, there has to be a determination that the injury was a result of the attacks or the debris removal. And if you are in the program, the World Trade Center program, that injury has already been found, if you're in the program, has been found to be related to 9/11. And that fact is very helpful for us and for you in making your claim. If you've been treated by a private physician and you are not part of the World Trade Center health program, then we're going to have to get your private physician to fill out certain forms that are similar to the forms that were filled out by your doctors here. And those forms are going to be submitted to the World Trade Center health program, and then a determination will be made that they are related to the World Trade Center injuries. So if we need medical records, we'll let you know. We don't want you to send us your medical records. And especially if you're in the World Trade Center health program, we don't want your medical records. We can get those ourselves. So that saves you a lot of time, money, and effort, and you don't have to provide them to us. This plan also covers death cases, but in order for you, for someone to file for a death case, you have to have a representative appointed by the court. You have to have a personal representative that's appointed by the court, and you have to show us papers showing that, because you can see what happens. Someone can die, they can have more than one wife, they can have children and a wife, they can have other relatives that are all fighting to represent that particular person. So we need a court that says this is the proper person to file the claim for someone that's dead, and a lawyer can help you do that. So that's an important consideration. Okay, we're going to talk now about compensation, and Fran's going to take you through this part, and also is going to show you a look at the website and what the website looks like, so that it will help inform you as to as to how to fill out the forms. And then we'll talk about some other general issues, and we'll open it up for questions. Thank you.
Good. Thank you, Sheila. So, you know, just let me go over, before we focus on the actual application process and the important deadlines, just to focus for a moment. Sheila spoke a little earlier about the overview in terms of compensation, which is comprised of, you know, three components. Economic loss, which could relate to, you know, wages or other medical expenses, you know, out of pocket. Non-economic loss, which can relate to things like, you know, pain and suffering. And just to be clear, I mean, the fund will establish certain criteria. I mean, everyone will be treated equally in terms of similar issues, in terms of, you know, physical issues in relation to non-economic loss. The third component relates to collateral offsets, and that is, you know, once the total, you know, economic loss and non-economic loss are compiled, for there are individuals who have received, you know, certain kinds of, you know, pension or other benefits, which essentially people, you know, won't be, you know, compensated twice for the same thing, and that would be deducted. But, you know, those are, you know, more individual, some of you may have individual situations. We'd be happy to, you know, answer some of that later. So again, important that each claim will be evaluated individually, and a determination, you know, will be made on the total loss calculation for each individual. Now, I'm going to talk about the application process, but want to again emphasize the main reason that we're here today, and you'll, you know, hear of other, you know, outreach information sessions we're doing in the near future and in the past couple of weeks. You know, Sheila spoke with you about this October 3rd deadline coming up. First, I just want to say, you should have handouts that you received when you came in today. One is a one-page sheet, which is a general September 11th victim compensation sheet, which includes a paragraph summary about what the fund is, but importantly, the website address that was mentioned earlier, this www.vcf.gov, and the helpline number for the Victim Compensation Fund. At any point in the process, if you have any questions regarding the status of your claim or specific questions as you're filling out the forms, you should not hesitate to call the helpline. They are there. They are there to help you, and the hours, I believe, you know, are listed. So, again, there are three components. The intent of the process was to make this as streamlined, transparent, and as easy as possible, so that there are, you know, many individuals who are, you know, filling out the forms themselves, and others, many who, as Sheila described, and we encourage people who need help to get an attorney. And again, the maximum that someone can be charged, the fee from an attorney, is 10%, and that's based upon the statute. So, again, in order to preserve your right to submit a claim, and this is based upon the Zadroga Act, it's important that people register if one either knew they had an injury, should have known that they had an injury, became aware of, were treated for any of the qualified injuries that you saw in the first list prior to the opening of the fund, which was October 3rd, 2011. So under the statute, you have 2 years in which to register. The fund is open, and we'll say this a number of times, and you have the other handout, is this filing deadline handout, reverse two pages, and one side has a chart, which if you look at it, it describes a number of the categories that might be applicable to you. But if you had that injury prior to the opening of the fund, you have 2 years from which to register. That deadline is coming up this October 2013. The registration process is quite simple and doesn't take a lot of time. We, you know, encourage people to file online through the website. You know, I'm going to show you in a little while what the homepage of the website is, but it's very easy to access. So either if you have access to a computer, you can register yourself, or if you have someone to help you to register, we urge you to register online. If you don't have access to the computer or cannot register online through the website, you can obtain a hard copy eligibility form through the helpline. The number is 1-855-885-1555. That number is on the sheet that was distributed to you. All you have to do, and you receive the hard copy, call the helpline to get the hard copy of the eligibility form. You only have to fill out the part one of the eligibility form and send it in. Again, we encourage people to register through the website online. It's more efficient, but there's another vehicle to do that. It doesn't take long. Sheila described some of the questions in the registration form, just basic information in terms of, you know, name, address, other identifying, you know, information, and whether you were a volunteer, a first responder, a resident, a worker in the area. And as for statistical purposes, we want to emphasize that regardless of your particular status or exposure, what you were doing when you were exposed at the crash site, everyone is treated the same for purposes of compensation. So whether you were a first responder, a resident, a volunteer, when it comes to evaluation of the compensation form, everyone is treated the same. So just further about those deadlines. So this October 3rd is the first two-year deadline. Again, if you had an injury that you knew about or should have known about prior to the opening of the fund, this October 3rd is the deadline. All you have to do is register. And if you have any question, if you're not sure in terms of the timeline and you think your deadline might be later, it doesn't hurt to register now, right? Sheila mentioned the addition of cancers. And again, you know, I say this is all laid out in the chart that you have in the two-page filing deadline. So the cancers is qualified condition. Certain cancers were added this past October 12th, 2012, which means, again, as a newly added conditions, you would have 2 years for which to register to preserve the right to submit a full claim, and that deadline wouldn't come up until October 12th, 2014. That does not preclude you from registering right now. You don't have to submit the full claim filing, and the full claim filing, and we'll talk about that in a moment, includes the submission of the eligibility and the compensation form. Regardless of what the particular two-year deadline might be for your individual situation, everyone must submit the completed submission, including the registration, eligibility, and compensation prior to the closing of the fund, which is October 3rd, 2016. Again, it's laid out on the handout you have. Now, some people you might ask, what if I have a condition that that became evident to me I knew about prior to the opening of the fund and I'm going to register now, or I've already registered? What if today you discover that you have a new condition that's included in the list of qualified conditions that you didn't know about prior? Then you would have 2 years from, let's say, today, which is July 31st, 2013, you would have to July 31st, 2015 to add that. You can amend your claims. So if you think that, well, maybe I'm going to get something else, or I'm not sure that I might, maybe I'll wait, don't wait. If you have an injury that falls within the realm of what we spoke about that you have now, you should apply, register. Again, same 2 year, if any new injuries are added to the list of qualified injuries, you would have 2 years from the time that the fund adds those. Okay. Very important point, we can't say this enough. The Victim Compensation Fund, in terms of registration, is Sheila described under the DROGA Act, is the World Trade Center Health Program, which provides medical treatment, and the Victim Compensation Fund, which focuses on compensation for individuals for those injuries. They're two separate funds. If you are registered in the World Trade Center Health Program, for example, many of you, if you are registered and certified here at Mount Sinai, you must register separately for the Victim Compensation Fund. If you were registered in the health registry prior, you have to separately register for the Victim Compensation Fund.
Because some people think that if they're in the World Trade Center Health Program, if you're in the Mount Sinai program and you're getting treatment, that automatically does something for you. It does not. You have to file again in our program. It's a separate program. And we don't want anyone to lose out because they think they're registered in the World Trade Center Health Program. It will help you that you are registered there. It will give you a leg up because you have an injury that we would compensate you for, but you have to file online or in hard copy again because that's not sufficient for our program. So I know most of you are in the program in the World Trade Center Health Program, but if you haven't registered in our program, we can't compensate you. So if there's anything you take away from this, you have to go on our website and register again and fill out our forms. It's a separate, different program. It helps you that you're in this program, but it doesn't mean that you don't register again. Okay? This is very important because most of you are in the program.
And I'll add further, if you registered to attend this information session today and got a confirmation of your attendance here, You're not registered in the Victim Compensation Fund. I mean, you know, I might think I was registered. I don't know. And when you ask your questions, there's no question that, you know, you think about it, somebody else will have the same question. But again, we can't emphasize that enough. In addition, if you were part and received compensation in the first Victim Compensation Fund, as Sheila mentioned earlier, we will have those records. We will get have access to the information in terms of, you know, what you received, you were at the site, but you still have to register separately for this fund, for the current Victim Compensation Fund. We can't say that enough. And again, everyone sitting here today, you have time to October 3rd, 2013 coming up. But we can't say that enough. Just make sure you've registered. If you're not sure whether you've registered, call the helpline if you have any question.
If you're not sure, if your attorney registered you,
that's right.
Call the helpline, and we will tell you whether you're registered or not. All right? So we'll answer your questions. If you just hold off, we're almost done.
Okay? Yeah, let me just quickly go through just a few important tips that relate to some of the things that Sheila said earlier in terms of the filing of your material in order to help us to help you. And that is, when you submit your forms, any of them, particularly when we're talking about the eligibility and the compensation forms, it's really important that they be completed totally, and where there are places that ask for signature or initial, it's important that you review that if you have an attorney, with your attorney, because if it's not complete, then the reviewer will have to send a letter back saying it's incomplete. Really importantly, in some instances, you will be asked if you're applying online, to upload the certain exhibits, affidavits, and attestations that may ask for original signatures. Sometimes they call them, and your attorney might call them wet signatures, but original signatures. And the reason that that's important, Sheila spoke earlier about our ability to get information on your certification, for example, with NIOSH, through the health programs that you're enrolled in, the certification regarding certain injuries. In order for us to get the information from, whether it's NIOSH, Social Security, it's their requirement. They require original signatures in order for us to get that information. And so if you don't submit it in a timely fashion, it really just slows down the process.
Can I just emphasize this again? Because many people have gotten themselves behind in the process because they have not sent us these original signatures. And we ask that they be sent separately, and some of this cannot be uploaded to a computer. It's not us. We wouldn't care. We would take, a photocopy. But it's other government agencies and other employers that require this. So we have gotten in contact with lots and lots of applicants who have not given us the original signature pages. When it says original, when it says wet signature, that means you have to sign it and send it to us separately. We can't take it through the internet, because we have to give it to other agencies. It's not something we want you to go through. It's an extra step for you. It's an extra step for us. But it is required.
Yeah, sorry.
Okay? So, bear with us on that. We don't want to be doing this. We don't want to be having you to do this. But you have to, because we have to.
Yeah, in the same respect, when you provide information about your, you know, employers in order for us to get information on, you know, your presence, for example, that information should be completed, fully. In some instances, Michela talked about the being able to demonstrate presence at the site, where in some instances, you know, your employers may not be in business any longer, or they may not have the records, and you're going to, or volunteers, right? Anyone, residents, volunteers, any category, and will, you know, accept to, you know, other, you know, elements of proof in terms of, you know, for example, affidavits. It's important that they be, you know, as specific as possible to create, you know, a credible picture of your presence there. So the more specific it is, and appropriate signatures. Again, if you have attorneys, they will help you with that. This is the website, and again, the website is quite expansive, full of information. It's updated, you know, that section on the left there, what's new, updated practically, you know, weekly. We have some other new piece of information that's up there. But importantly, for what we're talking about here right today, focusing on the registration, if you see, I see this works, right? See that? Does that work? Yeah. Well, how to file a claim on top, you go on the website and you click on how to file a claim, you'll be able to access the registration form very easily. And again, if any trouble accessing this information on the website, call that helpline number, all right?
Can I point out a couple of other things? First of all, if you are a Spanish speaker, Polish speaker, Chinese speaker, there is translations on the website. There's a video on the website that takes you through every piece of the application screen by screen and explains to you how to fill it out and what are the issues. There's a place on the website in which you see FAQ that's frequently asked questions. When we get a question that we think other people might ask, we put it on the website with the answer. So if you had questions that were important to everybody, everybody can see the answers to them. They're long. There are a lot of questions. We're revamping the website to make it easier for you to get to the questions you want quickly. But this is a great source of information for you. Spend as much time on the website as you want. You can spend as much time, just save the application, and you can keep coming back to it. So it's meant to be user-friendly. For some of us, it is user-friendly. For some, it isn't. It depends on how familiar you are with using kinds of online information. Just hold it one more minute. We got one or two more slides, and then we'll take all your
questions. Yeah, and you know, just again, you see, this is a sample of what you have in your handout, that important deadline chart, and it excuse me, summarizes the various categories. This is the website and helpline number, and again, you have that in the handout, but again, we can't emphasize enough this. All you have to do is register by October 3rd. It's simple. It doesn't take time. And again, registration with the VCF is different than registration with the health program.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good questions.
If you have questions, if you could come up to the microphone on either side and just make a line, we will answer your questions. And anybody that wants to ask a question privately or with us, we're going to hang around and get your questions answered. Sir, right here?
Yes.
If we could just give people a chance to hear.
Assume that I do everything that I'm supposed to do. I register, I get an attorney, and you all decide that I'm entitled to a bucket of cash. And the attorney takes his 10% plus his expenses. And the expenses amount, what prevents the attorney's expenses from equaling 89% and I end up with a chocolate bar?
That's not going to happen under this program, because most of the expenses are not covered. There are only certain expenses that the attorneys can take as a result of what we have told them they can take. So there are just necessary, what we call necessary expenses. For example, we're not paying the attorneys to get an expert. That's where they could add on a lot of kinds of money. It's only the bare essentials of getting certain documents that they can charge you in addition to the 10%. And if there's any problem, when the time comes, you get back to us and we'll make sure that it doesn't happen. So that should not be a problem under this plan.
Thank you.
We can alternate mics.
Who are us, though? Are you VCF?
We're VCF.
I spoke to VCF.
Okay.
The VCF said they have nothing to do with this meeting tonight. I spoke to them. I'm telling you the truth.
Well, I am the special master of the VCF. This is the director of New York office, so I think we know who we are.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry if you got the wrong
information. This is the information I got that I told them I was going to this meeting, and I told them I already have a VCF number.
Okay.
Which I have. I have an attorney.
You've registered. Okay.
They said this. Let me just clear my head on this. Now, is this meeting for people that already have an attorney already with a VCF number?
This is for anyone who has a question, but we'd rather answer the questions of people who have not registered or people that have not yet gotten an attorney. So if you have a
question. I registered.
Do you have a question?
My question is, being that I have a VCF number already, and I have an attorney representing me, is the World Trade Center Mount Sinai still going to represent me along with my attorney?
No, they're not going to represent you, but you're still in the World Trade Center Health Program, and you'll still be treated in the World Trade Center Health Program.
Who am I better off with, the World Trade Center?
You can do both. It's both. You don't have to pick and choose. You can continue to get medical treatment here, and you can continue to get get compensation if you meet the requirements.
I know, which I do.
Okay.
Hi, good evening. Thank you so much for this forum. I have a two-part question.
Okay.
First question is, what happens when a patient is a disagreement with the WTC doctors that are treating them and their primary care doctors? That's the first question. Last question is, you talked about cancer. Is prostate cancer added to that cancer list? Those were the two things I wanted to know.
Let me answer your second question first, because it's easier. The second question is, prostate cancer is going to be added. There is a requirement that you have to give notice that you're adding it. NIOSH, National Institute of Safety and Health, has given notice that they're going to add prostate cancer. It will probably be added soon, and therefore it will be compensated for once it's added.
Okay.
Secondly, if you're having a problem with the World Trade Center Health Program and a private physician as to what's covered or not covered.
No, it's not what, okay. The world, at the very beginning, the World Trade Center doctors was all gung-ho, yes, you have a problem, you know, we see it, we recognize it, you know, I'm coming there, you sending me here, 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 here. Now, all in a sudden, nothing is wrong with you.
Mm-hmm.
But the primary care doctor is saying, is that doctor crazy? So, you know, what do you do in that case?
Okay, for our program, what that means is if you apply to our program for compensation,
yes.
If the World Trade Center program certified you for certain conditions, we'll accept that. If you have other conditions that a private doctor you're seeing who says you have that, you let us know that when you do the application, we will send a form to the private physician for them to fill out, for us to get reviewed, and that will be reviewed. And if there's sufficient evidence that it's connected, that would be included as well.
Okay, thank you so much.
I just have, I guess it's like a procedural question. If you have the VCF number, that means that you're registered? That's the one thing. And then if you, like, can you file the part about the eligibility form separate and then do the actual claim later on?
Yes.
Is there any type of deadline, like once you start the eligibility form?
No, but let me just, those are really good questions because I think, you know, other people have those questions. Let me start with your first comment about VCF number. I think I said it earlier, but it's really important when you begin the registration process. Again, it's short and simple, but when you begin it, make sure you complete it. You know you've completed when you get a VCF number. We have people who have begun, but they haven't completed it. You haven't really preserved that right to submit a claim until you've completed it. If you are unsure about whether or not you've completed the registration process, call the helpline number. With respect to your other questions on the eligibility and the compensation form, again, regardless of the individual particular 2-year deadlines to register, everyone must submit completed eligibility and compensation forms before the fund closes, which is October 3rd, 2016. We are encouraging people, once you've submitted the eligibility form, we actually now do encourage people to complete and submit the compensation form just to get it going and have it submitted, you know, even though the fund needs to review the eligibility to determine eligibility first, but we encourage that.
Because let me just tell you, the quicker you get the forms in, if there are things missing, we can go back to you and let you know they're missing and what might be needed. We have to go out to third parties to get information as well. So as soon as you can get it in, get it in. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you for tonight. That was very, very good. Very, very informative. I appreciate it very much.
Thank you.
And I'm sure everybody else did too. At the beginning, when we filled out paperwork with the lawyers, it was something like a WT-12 form. Does that have anything to do with the VCF-1? We filled it out with the lawyers, and they said that they would get back at us to us with the information. As far as injuries go, as far as filing for funds, does that have anything to do with this that we're talking about now? Because this appears to be another application, another registration that I am not familiar with at all.
Let me suggest this to you. First of all, call the helpline number that we gave you. That's on the information. Give them your name. Ask them if you have a file, if a registration has been filed for you.
Okay.
They will tell you that. If it hasn't, go back to your lawyer and tell your lawyer that you have checked and you don't have a registration number, as he registered you for the Victims Compensation Fund.
Okay, so that Victims Compensation Fund is the same Victims Compensation Fund as this?
Yes. It is called the Victims Compensation Fund.
Okay,
there's only one Victims Compensation Fund that you can get money from. That's our fund. You can get treated here at Mount Sinai under the World Trade Center health program. That is different fund. It has nothing to do with us directly, although it has a lot to do indirectly.
Okay, my second question is, I have mentioned this many times before in other meetings, but have you developed a compensation for people who did the alternate route of nutrition getting better versus medication?
It doesn't affect us whether you got better through nutrition or medication. What affects us is if you've been diagnosed with an injury that has been found to be related to the World Trade Center catastrophe, and if you've lost economic loss, if you've lost wages, if you have medical expenses, if you have drug expenses. So it doesn't matter what kind of treatment you had. Do you have bills to show you have that treatment? If you do and you have the injury, you can recover.
I appreciate that. Thank you very much.
Sir?
Yes, I'd like to know, I'm trying to find out if, I always get problems with my skin on my legs. I break out with sort of like hives every time, and it bleeds. And is there any coverage for that type of situation? Because they always keep telling me, I went to three different doctors, it's eczema, and then I find out it's not eczema.
Well, I don't know what condition it is. It is not one of the conditions that has been named as a condition that is related. But that doesn't mean that if you can find a doctor that thinks it's related, apply, we'll look at it. If we find that it isn't, we won't compensate you. If we find that it is, we will. But it has to be related, and in this situation, it's not one of the injuries that is deemed. Okay? Good luck.
Good evening to the panel, and good evening to each one of you over here presenting today. And I was the first responder for 9/11, happened to work under Red Cross and also under the FEMA administration. I work as a peace officer for 26 Federal Plaza. I was posted in a Pier 92 in the West Side Highway. So now I'm suffering from multiple myeloma and also suffer from my kidney. I was in coma for almost a month, and now and penniless because nothing has been done to help me out financially. How can I do so to overcome all this difficulty in my life? Plus, I apply for the worker comp. Nothing will be done. They tell me I got to go to my doctor over here to Mount Sinai. I'll be denied, and so. Even so, my case is proved. Can you tell me what procedure we take? I have a lawyer and everything, and it seems like things going quite well. But to this point, financially, I'm suffering.
Yeah. So are you in the Mount Sinai program?
Yes, ma'am.
You are. Okay. So, and you have a lawyer and have
absolutely
applied for the fund?
Yes, ma'am.
So it sounds like your claim will be reviewed if you're, you know, attorney has submitted your eligibility and then
yes,
the compensation
ma'am
form, then again, as you know, Sheila mentioned earlier, we have a mechanism to get the medical, you know, certification information from NIOSH, you mm-hmm know, as a result of your registration mm-hmm with the health program,
mm-hmm,
and then the full claim will be reviewed.
Yeah, but
we don't. You know, just with respect to the workers' comp submission, that's not us. We're the victim compensation fund.
Yeah, but what happened from the worker comp, they asked me to get the info from the doctor, the acceptable report. I let us, this way they could pursue, I give me my compensation work from then. And today, when I come to over here to Mount Sinai, the doctors always reviews to give me a help in that.
Well, I think you can talk to the people back there at Mount Sinai then. But You're in our program. We are reviewing your file. You will get a letter from us. And if you want to make sure you're in the program and have been the lawyer.
I know I am.
You are. And you're yes. fine.
Okay. Thank you.
You just have to be a little patient, and we will get to your form. And it sounds to me like you will get compensation from the fund.
Okay?
Hi, good evening. I'm actually asking a question on behalf of my husband. He's not here today because he suffers from such awful anxiety. I apologize.
Sorry to hear that. Do you want to talk?
No, it's okay. I'm sorry. I just get a little emotional.
All right.
I've had a very hard time with his union. He was a court officer at the time. And his union gave us 4 months of runaround for us to just get a notice from them saying that he was at the Manhattan Family Court and he was a first responder. I finally had to do a FOIA request. I'm an attorney. I had to do this Freedom of Information Act for him. All I was able to do was obtain just a piece of paper from them stating that at the time he was at the Manhattan Family Court. That's it. That's all I was able to obtain from them. My husband still has the uniform that he wore on that day. Is there anything else that we need for him?
Yeah, if you can wait around, come up to me afterwards, and I'll talk to you about how we can take care of this.
Okay? I apologize.
No, don't apologize at all. We'll take you through it, and we'll make sure that you get what you need.
I'm a little emotional myself. I just wanted to ask about the proof of presence. The previous attorney went through all that with my employer. And Mount Sinai, I thought, had also duplicated it, or at least confirmed it. What you're saying, though, is I have to get new approval. Like, for instance, my partner that I worked with while I was down there passed away from related illnesses already. I had to get information for his wife as well. I only know one person that I reported to at Ground Zero that is still around. I can call him. I can get a letter from him. He's retired and in Florida now. How do you go about getting this proof if you have an uncooperative? I was working in a union position, and I worked in Westchester. I volunteered to come down and work here. And it got contentious at the end with the union, and it was insanity. I don't know how I will get proof.
Well, let's just talk about it for a moment, okay? This is very emotional for everyone. It brings back memories. It's a very hard process. And, you know, we're 10 plus years away from the event. And we understand that. And it's very difficult for some people, and especially the volunteers, because it's much easier if you work as a policeman, a fireman, one of the unions where there is information. The volunteers have a very hard job. We understand that in getting proof. And if you look on the web, and if you have a lawyer, your lawyer should be able to get that for you, and you should talk to your lawyer. But if you look on to the on the website, if you had a uniform, if you had a card, if you had it, there is a whole level of things we will take that can establish presence. And if all those things you don't have, then we will take an affidavit from someone that can say, I was down there with you, I saw you, etc. If you have letters from the union that anything at all, and if you don't have anything, tell us your story, and we'll try to do what we can to get the information for you. So we are very lenient on these issues. We want people to be included, not excluded. We understand the difficulties. Look at the website, see what we will accept, and what are the substitutes for what we'll accept, and we'll do the best we can. Okay? Good luck to you.
Thank you.
Okay? Yes, sir.
Yes, thank you very much, ladies, for helping us. One of the questions is that if I won my workman's comp award and it was awarded to me, does that mean that I was present at the World Trade Center? Is that substantial proof?
What did you do at the center? What were you doing? Were you a first responder? Or?
Yeah. Yes.
It certainly is a big step up. If they recognized that and gave you workers' comp as a result of it, that's very useful.
Okay, so do I have to go through something similar like the other young lady that was here, going through FOIL to prove that I was working there for 5 months?
What were you doing there, and who were you working for?
I worked for the New York City Transit Authority, and I was an electrician, and I worked there for 5 months.
Just fill out the form. Tell us what you did. If you have any evidence of that, if you had a union card, if you had, you could go onto the website, you could see all of the varied documentation we will take. And it is very varied.
I have pictures and everything. I mean,
that's
I
could, perfect.
That's
Send
good.
Us a picture.
Okay, sure.
That would be very helpful. Anybody that has pictures of you yourself at the World Health World Trade Center, send us the pictures. That's excellent proof.
Right. Just
what's that?
You can get paid.
Doesn't matter if you were a volunteer. That's perfectly fine.
Just another question. I paid for my workman's comp. I paid the lawyer $11,500. Is that something that you're going to give me back?
Probably not, because you got something for it, which was the workers' comp. So that's not what we would consider an out-of-pocket expense. But tell us that in the form somewhere,
okay?
Because we have to deduct from the award what you got from collateral sources. And workers' comp is a collateral source. So it's important for us to know that we can take it into consideration.
Well, just one other quick question.
Sure.
I retired. My doctors I had seen before I retired in 2002, 2003, and I was complaining about conditions. They knew nothing about it. In 2006 of March, I came to the World Trade Center, and immediately there was a problem.
Mm-hmm.
There was nodules, the sleep apnea that I was complaining about. My own private doctors knew nothing about what was going on. I ended up having to retire because of that. How far back do I go about compensation?
2006 would be fine. I mean, whenever you finished working.
2004, I retired because I couldn't sleep.
Okay.
I was done.
Just give us all that information in the application,
and
we will look at it all.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
You're very welcome.
Hi, I wish to thank you both for being here this evening. I'm speaking on behalf of my husband, and he has a few qualified injuries that he's being treated for by the World Trade Center Health Program. My question is, you mentioned earlier regarding other criterias. My husband has been certified. He's part of the NIOSH database, and I believe his proof of presence was satisfied by his employer, although it was a bit inaccurate because the number of days and hours were not correct. He invested a lot more time. He was an employee. He was not a volunteer. My question to you is, these other criteria that you were referring to, can you please describe them for us?
Do you mean in addition to, well, the presence and you?
Well, I wasn't clear when you mentioned other criteria after furnishing proof of presence, and I guess you were referring to NIOSH and.
Well, the relationship, you said that if the injuries are, you know, certified mm-hmm. by NIOSH, one of the health programs, one of the criteria, you know, relates that one could have an injury on the list of qualified injuries, mm-hmm. but it has to relate to having obtained that as a result of, you know, exposure at the site.
And that leads to my next question. I had assisted in the application for workman's compensation for my husband. And one of the attorneys that I spoke with to obtain representation indicated that we needed to obtain a letter from a doctor indicating that it was related.
Right.
I have not yet came across one doctor who is treating my husband who can say, yes, this was linked to the attacks.
What about the Mount Sinai program? If you're in the Mount Sinai program, you can use one of those doctors.
We submitted that. I haven't received any feedback yet, but I was just curious to know whether there are others out there who are also finding a challenge to say that doctors are not stating that it's connected.
I think there probably are. I know the city has fought certain workers' comp applications. So I would assume that there are others in your same situation. But it sounds to me, if you have proof that your husband was present at the World Trade Center site, if he's part of the program, if he's being treated for the injuries that are deemed to be World Trade Center health-related injuries, then you will be part of this program. The only other thing now is you'll have to give us information on what the lost earnings were, what out-of-pocket expenses you sustained as a result of that for drugs, for other sort of replacement services. It sounds to me like you have done what you need to do. So if you have any issues, call the helpline or send us a letter. Sounds to me like you're on the right place.
Thank you.
Good luck to you.
Yes, sir. Good evening, Nichols. I've been with the World Trade Center since the very beginning when there was in Bellevue, and I've been certified with sleep apnea, GERD, and a few other things, and breathing problems. One problem that I also have is acid reflux, but my doctor in Mount Sinai won't cover it because it wasn't notified in time, or it wasn't reported in a certain time limit that they have for my acid reflux. My throat doctor disagrees with that. He says it should be covered because one thing leads to another, and my other doctor, my lung doctor, disagree with that also. But right now I'm getting prescriptions for my acid reflux, but this is my last one. It won't cover it. I could get it through the VA, through the other source, the GHI, but I was wondering anything I could do.
Well, I think the answer to that is when you put in your application, or your lawyer puts in an application, tell us about the issue. Tell us that you have GERD, that you're getting medication for GERD, and what that medication costs, if you're paying for it out of your pocket. If you're not paying for it and it's being covered through another program, we can't compensate you for that. But the answer, if you have some of the injuries and all of them are not covered, some injuries are and some aren't, it doesn't mean that you're not going to get the same amount of money. Because if you can show lost earnings, if you could show out-of-pocket medical expenses, you're still going to get the same amount of money even though each of your conditions are not covered, as long as some of your conditions are covered.
Yeah, but my concern is not mostly about the money, is that if I do have acid reflux, I could get throat cancer, I could get stomach cancer. They refused to, my throat doctor wanted for me to do a procedure to look at my stomach. It was turned down because the acid reflux wasn't caught in time.
Yeah.
I didn't report it, or for my negligence, or whatever part.
Yeah, but unfortunately, there's nothing we can do about that because that's a different program, and you would have to do an appeal to the World Trade Center Health Program. They have an appeal process.
They do have an appeal process?
I think they do, and I think you should look up on their website to see how you would do that.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Good evening. Thank you for hosting us. My question is, Adam, if you do work in a World Trade Center and if you have immigration problems, you are not allowed to file in on this program?
There is no requirement that you have to be a citizen in order to apply. But you have to show that you have the presence, that you were there, that you have the injury, and you can apply like anybody else, even though you are not a citizen.
No, I'm a citizen now, but okay. At the time I work with a trio, and I work in a World Trade Center. I have already been documented, but my lawyer called up the company that I work for, but they deny me. They refuse to produce all the areas that I work with them. I'm a company man. I work for them in full, but they deny me. They wouldn't produce all the papers and where the site I work. Rather, they telling the lawyer that at the time I work in a World Trade Center that I was not documented. But I have a pay stub here that can verify that I was documented. I have a work permit, but they deny me not to,
Well, there are other ways to prove it, to prove that you were there. If there's any way you can prove you were working there.
I was working
there. By a coworker, if you know somebody, who can vouch that you were there, even though the employer won't give you that information. We need to get some evidence from someone other than yourself.
Yeah, sorry, but talking of co-workers, this has been about 10 to 11,
well,
12
know,
years
I
know,
it's now. Not easy.
And I'm African, and the people that I work with on that side are Spanish and they're Polish people.
Right.
Most of them, I don't know where they are because I don't feel too good. I went back to drive a limousine or a cab. I've been doing that since 2004. But, to get somebody who can be able to double, sign that for me, it's very difficult, to me.
Come see me after the program.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Good evening, ladies. How are you?
Thank you.
Listen, I worked at the World Trade right now. Now, I've been recently diagnosed with prostate cancer, okay? All right, now, my question is, how am I supposed to be compensated for this? Because I'm about ready to retire now, and I've been going through a lot of difficulties with this treatment. Is it possible?
Well, so just as Sheila mentioned earlier, in the process in the NIOSH, just evaluation in terms of the, review and posting on the regs for NIOSH, it's expected that it will be, included as one of the eligible conditions added to the list of cancers. Under the Victim Compensation Fund rules, determined in the rules that should, NIOSH add, any physical injury condition, that the Victim Compensation Fund would add it as well. So if prostate cancer is added, which is expected, as of the date that that's added, then you would have, assuming you had it prior to the inclusion, you'd have 2 years from the time it's added in order to register with the fund. And in the same respect, assuming that you would be treated by, if you're treated by one of the health programs like Mount Sinai, then again, if they deem the relationship between the condition and exposure at the site, then you get certified and that information would come to the fund.
Now, I also have that GERD and that respiratory,
Okay.
Among other things. But the thing is that I submitted all this. I put all this information. It's in my attorney's presence now. And I call from time to time. I have the registration number, and I ask them, when would I be compensated for it? They said my case is still under review.
So. Okay, a couple of points, because you raised some, just really important questions. Let me just sort of raise one, address one first. You said that you mentioned a couple of conditions, including GERD, which currently are, listed.
Okay.
and you filed. So I think, as we mentioned earlier, should a new condition such as prostate cancer be added after you've filed, even after you've submitted your eligibility and compensation form, the claim can be amended. So even if you filed for the other two, should another condition like prostate cancer be added, then you would you could amend the claim. Again, in terms of the status of your claim, you know, regarding not knowing when you would be compensated, you know, you have a VCF number. If you know, again, in addition to asking your attorney the information, you should feel free to call the helpline to find out the status of your claim in terms of whether the eligibility form and or the compensation form have been submitted.
It's not only submitted, it has to be completed, and then we have to check certain things, so it takes a little while. And I appreciate the patience that you and others have had. We have to meet certain criteria for the government to approve this whole process, so it has taken longer than we would have liked, but we are moving as quickly as we can, and you will certainly be told, you know, what's been included. But for you, it's important that prostate is going to be added, so if your lawyer put in that claim, it's going to take a little time because it hasn't been added yet. Okay? Yes, sir.
Good evening. Regarding the retaining a lawyer, if one has retained a lawyer or is retaining a lawyer, obviously you sign a retainer. The retainer addresses or includes that they can take expenses. You've already addressed that in an earlier question. It also includes that basically if you end up settling on your own, the lawyer can come after you for its 10% plus expenses. Is there a provision there for this second part? The retainer also doesn't give any provision for, if you're not pleased with the lawyer, for dismissing this lawyer or not using them anymore. Is there any provision within the law that supersedes if a lawyer actually does find out after a little while that the lawyer does underperform or is not trying very hard or is just putting your case onto an intern or something? Is there a provision within the law that you can actually dismiss them, supersede that retainer?
Absolutely. Hey, you can dismiss any lawyer even if they have a retainer. Lawyers can, if you get money, can then try to put a lien on it based on the work they did. But if they didn't do any work, they're not going to put a lien on it. Oh. But you can dismiss a lawyer, get another lawyer. You're not stuck with that lawyer.
Is that okay? And on the expenses, a slight more detail on the expenses. If one does have, as a chap just brought up earlier, an uncooperative witness for an affidavit, if one does have that, is that constitute? And let's say the lawyer has to help you, you know, find other proofs, this, that, and the other. Does that constitute, you know, a reason for lamping on what some might call excessive expenses? Because you said that's sort of criteria for expenses.
There are only very few expenses that are going to be covered by this program. The lawyers know what they are. If you have any, I think there's what we call a frequently asked question as to what are the expenses that are covered. Go on the website, take a look at them. I don't remember it offhand, but it's only necessary expenses, and they should be few. And if it isn't, you can always let us know. You can write to us. You can talk to our helpline. We will investigate.
Yeah. Okay, so just to confirm then, after just 1 week or so, one wants to retract this lawyer retainer, one can do that then?
Yes.
It's none of this 72 hours or any of that stuff?
No, nothing like that. Okay. You can fire a lawyer at any time.
All right, thank you so much.
You know, there's also a frequently asked question on that, if you substitute for another lawyer.
Or just go with yourself. Or just go with yourself as well.
Yes, but you know, you have to let the fund know.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Just have to let the fund know that you are now appearing for yourself and to take the lawyer off the form.
Yeah, in writing. And again, you know, if you want to do that and you want to clarify, call the helpline. But you want to take the action.
Yes, please.
Hi, I'm Susan. I just want to ask you a question about disability. If you're disabled and Social Security disability is said that you're disabled and workers' comp says you're disabled, are you saying that, and I thought I saw it in the FAQs, in like the three section, that you also have to make a determination that like their determinations aren't enough, that you have to look at everything and decide?
Well, you can be disabled, but that doesn't mean you're establishing that you were present at the time, within the period and in the vicinity.
No, that was disabled from the World Trade Center.
So, if that's there, then you're probably going to be fine.
Okay, and then do you need to have...
And what was, when you were at the World Trade Center site as a worker, as a resident, as what?
As a volunteer. I'm also a resident, but I was a volunteer.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm asking you is, are you saying that you need a copy of the decisions with the original signature from... say Social Security from the judge? I didn't understand what you meant.
You don't,
what do you mean by original
documents?
All
you need, the original signatures are for the authorizations that are attached to the form that allow us to get information from the Social Security.
Oh,
from
I see
NIOSH.
What you mean. Like, our
you don't need to give
like,
us
okay,
anything.
You just need the approvals. Like
that's
saying
the,
it's okay
the
if
author,
you
it's
that.
Called
okay.
the authorization.
Okay, all right, I understand that.
It's you know, it's part of the
right,
eligibility
okay,
package.
Right. I understand. I didn't understand what you're saying. I thought you were saying that you need the documents originally from Social Security. I was like, that would take forever.
No.
My other question is, you talked about injuries. So are you saying that if you have 10 injuries, you're going to get paid the same amount based on injuries as you would for one injury? There's
probably
like a set
not.
Number.
Probably not, because if you have cumulative injuries, mm-hmm. you may have more disability. We're going to look at each one of these as to the amount of the disability, the amount of the economic loss, the amount of pain and suffering. So if you have 3 or 4 or 5 conditions.
What is the baseline payment for an injury?
There is no baseline payment. Every one of these is treated individually based on the economic loss. Some people have lots of economic loss, some people have no economic.
I guess I'm confused. I thought that just for being injured, that's separate from economic loss. Like economic loss would be, you know, you're not working.
That's what we call the non-economic loss. There's pain and such. If you qualify for everything else, mm-hmm. and you have no economic loss, you can still get what we call non-economic loss. And that depends on the level of disability as well.
So you don't get non-economic loss if you have economic loss?
No, you can get that. You get the economic loss plus.
But you're talking about something that is like a level, and then you have four different like, you know,
categories.
So what are those? And what is, so you're saying that there's one level that, and then it goes up.
Yeah,
are numbers attached to that, or how does that work?
It depends on the amount of disability. The lowest amount you can get if you qualify is $10,000.
Right, but like if workers' comp or whatever and Social Security say you're disabled, then what I'm saying is, are you saying, yeah, you're disabled? Or are you reviewing everything again?
We are looking at what is reported to us, and we will look at the disability that the various, whether it's Social
Security.
You probably
have their decisions.
What's that?
You have their decisions.
Right. We will have their decisions. They send it to us. We will review them.
So you're not taking for granted that their disability is not necessarily what your definition of disability.
No, it's very helpful to have that.
Okay.
It's very helpful to us, but we have a different way of looking at it than they may look at. But it's very helpful.
What, though? I don't understand what the difference is.
Well, because we have to provide you with compensation. If you're getting disability, that's going to be deducted from whatever the award would have been. Let's say you get an award of $1 million. If you're getting Social Security disability, that's a deduction from the award. We have to make a calculation that's based on your economic loss, your non-economic.
I understand it. You know, it's so insignificant what I'm getting from Social Security that it would be like, it barely would affect me.
It may be insignificant, but it has to be taken into consideration.
Right, but I'm just wondering if the, okay, I guess I'm just, we're kind of going to
Yeah, why don't you come up at the end and we'll talk to you about it.
I'm sorry, what?
Why don't you come up at the end?
Okay.
And we'll talk to you then.
Yeah, sure.
Good evening, ladies, and thank you for all you do.
You're very welcome.
My name is Kasky. I work with the Port Authority Police Department in responding to 9/11. And my question is simply this. Does the VCF consider, or if not, maybe plan on considering, a responder's length of time working at the site, both respective to his or her responding on 9/11 and up to and the date of 30 May 2012, and even, for that matter, just in consideration for the weeks to months beyond that scope of those two dates? And I ask this question in relation to the STAC committee's findings, respective, as you know, to CDC and NIOSH, in regards to the 70 contaminants that they found and or at least have identified at the site in terms of responders breathing them in. And so if you look at the record of those who responded regarding all people considered, some were rotated out and some were not. Some were kept there by their departments and or certainly by themselves in terms of volunteering to stay for the duration between 9/11 and of course 30 May and certainly beyond. And considering the contaminants and considering the exposure, and although I know the VCF will not, or does not, I should say, consider the issue of PTSD respective to the qualifying issues, it at least, certainly, it qualifying the injuries that you have listed, which are more physiological, of course, in nature, would the VCF consider the length of time that one was down there in difference to not the length of time that was down there?
That's a very good question. And I think our mandate from Congress is to look at the economic loss. I mean, that's what Congress intended. And that is one of the reasons that Congress, no, we didn't decide this, Congress decided that it was not going to pay for post-traumatic syndrome or other psychological injuries that occur. So we have a mandate from Congress that we have to follow. And in that mandate, we are looking at the injury that people have. The fact that people may have been exposed, but they have no injury, and they have no economic loss. They can't yet. They cannot collect. If you get injured up to 2015, and we're still in business, you can apply, and you will be considered to be within the fund if you have one of the injuries. We can't do anything after that because we're out of business. And that's for other people and other times. We only can go with what Congress has provided to us. And other people will take up the cudgels after that to try to do whatever they can do to extend it. But unfortunately, if you don't have an injury, and even if you were exposed, we don't have any ability to compensate for that. You have to have an injury, and if you have an injury, then we have to look at the kind of disability you have now, project what that disability is going to be.
Roger that. The only thing, if I may suggest, is that considering the fact that these symptoms and conditions may catch up with all of us years from now, and as you state, you certainly may not be, as you put it, in business past a certain point.
I know I won't be in, but someone else may be.
2015.
Right.
All I'm saying is that in difference to a responder who was there a day or a week, and in regards to responders who were there weeks into months, even past May 30th, durationally speaking, they're probably more symptomatic to acquiring one of these illnesses and or beyond, even particularly cancers. And I would only ask on behalf of those who were there long, very long, to at least consider in respect to their case the duration of time that they were there.
I
the intensity, you were right at the collapse.
That's correct.
Well, the question is that, these are all good points, and if someone is injured now, that's going to be taken into consideration.
Okay.
But if you're healthy, God bless, that's a good thing, and we then can take it into consideration. But I appreciate what you said, and it's very valuable.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. I have a speaking disorder, which is what I want to address. Okay, I just have to give a little background here. Somehow or another, I was contacted by a law firm 3 years ago.
Can you do me a favor? If this is going to be, could you just wait and we'll talk to you separately? Because it sounds to me like this is very personal to you, and I'd like to get questions.
Well, it's just that the condition has been noted in my medical chart. I'm a health information management specialist who has not been able to do the work I do because of this condition, which is a very rare condition, but it has been seen, I know for a fact, 3 times in this program, if not more. And in my medical chart, it has been listed as a voice dysplasia or whatever. I don't know what the medical, I have the medical quote, but not on me. But it is not listed as one of the.
But you're being treated here at Mount Sinai?
There is no treatment. Okay. There is, it's a neurological disorder that has no treatment, but it is in my medical chart that this showed up in 2005, and the head of the department, doctor, I don't remember his name, included in the chart this medical code, but not for spasmodic dysphonia, which this is, because it cannot be tested in this program. So the question is, there is in my medical chart a medical code, and I'm well into the process with the attorney. I don't know how I got there, but I happen to be there. And this is the most debilitating. I have other problems, but this is the most debilitating.
We have the discretion to add rare injuries as long as we can establish some proof that it's related. So if your lawyer puts this into your application, we will review it. And if for some reason we don't approve it, you and your lawyer can appeal it. We have an appeal process. You can appeal it, and you can give us the information that you have again that explains why it's related, and we will look at it again.
Because I have made no claim on monetary, but I have not been able to continue my work. I'm a medical claims.
Well, you should put that all in the application.
I should put it in because I'm almost at the end. So at this point, I should contact my attorney and have this discussion with him.
And have him put it into the application, and we will examine it, and we will see if there's any relationship.
It's going to be, I mean, because I know other people have it. And if 55,000 people in the country have it, and 3 in the study have it, that is a significant number.
Put it in. We have the
approval. I will put it in. Okay. Now, one other question. As I said, I'm well into this process with this law firm. They came to me. I have no idea how they came to me. Mm-hmm. So can I assume that I have a VCF number, or should I still call?
No, call.
You should call the helpline number that you have, just to be sure that you, in fact, are registered and you have a VCF number.
What are the hours for that number?
It's, 9 to 5. It's on the website.
The compensation.
Monday to Friday.
Is it being made as the process continues? So in other words, you're not going to wait 10 years for compensation.
Let me, just summarize that. It hadn't come up, but I know people have that question in terms of, the payments. So, under Congress, the allocation for the fund is $2.775 billion, total.
It sounds like a lot, but a lot of people are
applying. Congress, determined that in the first 5 years, the fund is allocated $875 million, and if you $875 million
for
the first 5 years.
We only have $875 million to give away.
For the first 5 years.
In the first 5 years.
Starting
so
when?
If you, you know, again, this information is on the website.
Right.
In order to, you know, ensure that everyone who applies to the fund, who is eligible, gets an award, some compensation, we, with the help of, you know, actuarials, consultants, determined that if someone is found to be eligible and an award calculation is made for an individual, the first payment would be 10% of the award calculation. That would be the first check. At the end of the closing of the fund, because to determine how many people have applied and what the total calculation are, you know, is the total compensation determination for everyone, then a second payment would be made after the fund closes when we know how many people have, you know, applied. Having said that, if earlier we determine along the way that the expectation is fewer people or the award is left, it's conceivable that another payment would be made prior to the final. But the first payment would be, you know, 10%, and if you have an attorney, the attorney would be entitled to 10% of that first payment. Not 10% of your total award calculation, because you don't really know what your total compensation
but
award would be.
Only of the first payment, of the first. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
I have a couple of questions. I did register with VCF.
Did not, did you say?
I did.
Okay.
Just a couple of weeks ago and got a number. I wasn't sure, frankly, because I volunteered in a respite center at Ground Zero, what category to put myself under, whether first responder, and it looked to me like volunteer related to maintenance. So I couldn't put myself in any of those categories, so I sort of picked first responder just because. And that's, I just wanted to.
Okay, that's not going to make.
Not a problem.
That's only statistically for us. That's not going to affect your claim.
Everybody will be, you know, reviewed the same.
I worked at the hotel that was on site, a respite center. I think it's since been demolished in a capacity of providing hospitality for people prior to getting certification. I'm a social worker. And then got reassigned to the downtown area to work with family. Then I worked for Project Liberty out of the area.
Mm-hmm.
There's one person who was at the hotel with me for the few weeks that I was there. I'm not sure if Red Cross has records. So I volunteered prior to, I think, getting certification. I'm not sure. It's fuzzy in my mind. Exactly
okay.
What the process was, or maybe there was a Red Cross certification that got me on, because I must have had credentials to get onto the site at that time. But it was right after 9/11. I've had been diagnosed with two cancers since. So one question that I have has to do with establishing presence. Another question has to do with, since I had self-paid at the time health insurance. There were co-pays involved in terms of medical expenses, so I would have to go to the insurance companies and get a record of medication and procedural.
We need some evidence that you paid the co-pays yourself.
Right.
And that you paid for those medications.
Well, other than a check, let's say I paid it through a credit card. You know.
Do you have credit card receipts?
No, I mean like a debit card, credit card, that kind of thing.
If you got to give us some evidence.
Well,
that
if there was a copay, well, the doctor actually would certify that they received a copay, so that shouldn't be a problem. So I wouldn't do it through the insurance company in terms of
right.
What was the copay. I would
right.
Do it through the doctor's office
right.
Or the hospital.
Mm-hmm. Any evidence at all, we'll take it.
Okay. And it sounded to me also when you were making a presentation, which is very clear. added some information to me.
And for presence, if you go on the site, you'll see what documentation you can show us, or if you don't have that documentation, what we need. And if it comes a point where we reject your claim because you don't have the documentation, you can appeal that. And somebody, myself or one of the hearing officers, will listen to your story, and if you convince them that you were there, they will change the determination.
Okay. I'm wondering whether or not the Red Cross maintains records and how one would do
that. You could send a letter to the Red Cross. My understanding is they had very poor record keeping.
There may be an FAQ on that.
And also, I registered with the monitoring program pretty soon after, and I think they asked a detailed.
They did.
Yeah.
So. They did. So okay. But that's not going to help us. So you have to fill out ours separately.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Yes. I know you people have been waiting very late, very much. We got a couple of more, and then we're going to close down.
Yes.
Okay. Sure.
I've been certified by the World Trade Center here.
Okay.
I have multiple myeloma. 2008, I had a renal cancer that took out my right kidney. Carpal tunnel. I have a whole bunch of. I got a whole list of things that's wrong. But I'm a transit worker. Now, I haven't seen any of those people since maybe 2003. And you say I need affidavits.
No, if you have other evidence, if you have anything that shows that you were a transit worker, that you were down there, there's
worker. I didn't work on the pile. I'm a conductor. At City Hall, we have what they call a yard where trains would be put down. And every day, you know, being that part of the system was collapsed, we ran AM rush hour trains. During the afternoon, we only ran a few trains. So all the other trains were left down there in the yard. So we had to go down there and put the trains back in to bring them. In order for them to go back into service, we had to put the trains back in. We had to make sure all the doors were working, the lights were working, this and that, you know. Ventilation systems.
If you were spending time down anything south of Canal over a period of time.
But you're saying I need to get affidavits. I haven't seen any.
You need some proof that you were there.
Well, I worked in transit.
But that doesn't mean you were working there. You know,
they know from the job numbers that where you was working.
Well, then just ask them for that, or just give us the information and we'll get it for you. When you fill out the form, if you tell us where you worked, we will get that information from the transit form.
Okay. Now, I had seen, you said something about cancers weren't put on the list until October 2012.
Right. Yeah.
Right. I believe I was registered prior to that. Do I have to re-register?
No, you just have to supplement the application and tell us that you have these cancers. And if these cancers are ones that have been certified, then we will, you're amending your application and adding it to it.
All right.
And if you have any questions about it, call the helpline as to how you amend your application.
All right.
Okay?
Yes.
Do you have a lawyer? Yes
I
and no?
I saw one, but I want to look up there and see if he even registered.
Okay.
Yeah, do that.
Well, if you're not registered, you better be sure you get registered. That's the most important thing.
Yeah, right.
Okay?
Well,
if you learned anything tonight, get registered. Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Good evening, ladies, and thank you for the service that you're providing us. What I wanted to ask is, I noticed you had made a response regarding the status of the claim and saying we'd have to go on the website. I wanted to know, I enrolled online 2 years ago, went through the whole process, and then was notified to send additional evidence of my being I'm a first responder. I did that a year ago. I wanted to find out would I receive any notification that everything I had sent in was received and completed? Or would
Yes, you would. And if you haven't, could you do me a favor and just, if you know what your VCF number is, would you give us the number tonight? Or I'll give you some information of how to get me the number, and I will get it double-checked to make sure what its status is.
And my second question was in regards to the VCF number. And that was, would you be able to obtain your VCF number if you called the toll-free line? Because I don't have that number. I mean, I don't remember it. And when I've gone to the site, it's not very easy to manipulate the site, maneuver the site to get your number.
Okay.
Someone who's worked with computers for the last 20 years, where did your site shot?
Give me your name. Give me your name and telephone number and an email address, and we'll get a check for you.
I'll get it. Thank you very
okay?
much.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Special Master. I waited so I wouldn't have to stand up here too long.
All right, that's fine.
I have a couple of questions. One, I do have a lawyer, and I'm assuming, but I will check when I get home to make sure I'm registered. But I did have other questions. One thing was that the person I was, one of my coworkers that I was down at Ground Zero with, he died last July. He was on the bucket brigade. He had the same illnesses I had, and liver and lung issues. Now, at the time, my mortgage was very little. He said to me, oh, you're going to go for all these alternative treatments? And I said, yes. I said, because I have faith in them. I'm worried that I could die. I have tumors in my liver. And he said, well, I can't afford it. I said, you can take a loan. I said, it's not like I have the money. I'm going to have to borrow it. So I've gone from having hardly anything to, like, refinancing for $150,000 mortgage, so to pay for alternative treatments, which I'm sure you realize, unlike traditional medicine, you do them over a long period of time before you see results. And I did that coupled with the help I got at Mount Sinai. So I did all that. I can document most of it, you know, the big expenses to the alternative medicine doctors. Is that what you're talking
yes.
about?
Yes.
Okay. The other thing is, I feel very lucky I'm alive. You know, so some of me feels a little guilty even applying because he's dead and I'm alive, you know.
You shouldn't feel guilty about it.
But you understand what I'm saying.
Yes.
I just do feel that, you know, if I was still working, you know, I'd have a lot more money than I have with a lot less expense because I wouldn't have had to do all that. So when I file, I also have proof of documentation of being down there from my supervisor at the union as a first responder. I also have my mask, my original mask. I don't know how much you want. Do you want the mask?
Just go on the site. Need two pieces of proof. We have a whole list of things that we will accept, and they go in order of, you know, importance. And if you don't have any of those proofs, we take an affidavit, and if you don't have that, we'll take whatever you have. We're on your side. We want people to be able to get these benefits, but we need to have some evidence because this is not open to everybody because it's a limited fund.
Right.
You just have to understand.
I have my supervisor's letter saying that he directed me to be down there. But I also have this question. I have I was part of the first original VCF fund. I received a minimal amount of money for the asthma,
well, that,
breath,
if
and
you,
the GERD.
If you are in VCF 1, you don't have anything to worry about. That is proof enough.
Okay. The second issue, though, is some of those illnesses got worse.
That you can apply and tell us that. And we will deduct what we paid you, but you can apply for an exacerbation for it getting worse.
Okay, and how about an illness that they've now determined is autoimmune
you can
apply, related?
You can apply for that as well.
Thank
All
you.
Of that is covered.
Thank you.
Okay?
Thank you so
You're very well.
Two more.
I'm here because I was down at the World Trade Center, and you said compensation, you have to show expenses. Am I Clay on that?
Yes.
Because I really can't show expenses. I have things that I lost during the World Trade Center. I was working for the post office right adjacent to the post office. I mean, adjacent to the World Trade Center, and all my personal belongings and jewelry were gone. I've never been compensated for that. On top of that, I worked for the city of New York, and I was in the military at the time, and I lost all my vacation time, and I owe the city money now because at the time the World Trade Center went down, within 4 hours we were activated, and we had to work at the World Trade Center. I worked there till February 2002, and as a result of that, the city, whatever money the city give me, I have to pay it back to them. I'm still paying them back. So those were my financial losses.
Okay. Let me answer. The first one is easy. We don't cover for economic, for loss, for personal injuries, for property damage. That's not part of this fund. This fund is only to recover for what your personal injury was, injury to you from a health perspective. So we can't cover you for whatever disappeared at the World Trade Center, et cetera.
Well, that's fine. But the thing is that I have been in the program, the World Trade Center program, from the inception. And the issue is that I'm treated in both places, at the VA hospital and at World Trade Center, for practically the same thing.
Yeah, that's fine. If you've been treated here, you should apply. We can compensate you for any losses you had as a result of your injuries. And tell us about the fact that you just told us about, that you had to give money back. That could be an economic injury that we can take into consideration.
Okay. All right, thank you.
You're very
thank you.
I'm sorry.
That's right. As the last person, I want to thank the both of you for your time and effort. And you did explain a lot to me. But I did want to find out, more than anything, I've lost my health. I was there the second day as a volunteer. And I went down with a neighbor of mine because she wanted to get the news out to Europe, and I thought it was important that they firsthand would get it immediately. So I went down with her. And then I went back to help people. I figured I'd help somebody who was younger or whatever. But anyway, I lost everything, my home, which I had for 40 years. I didn't think they'd come after me because of my age, because of my problems with the 9/11 thing and my health. But I lost that. I'm now living in a small room up in Harlem because I figured it would be close to Mount Sinai in case of an emergency. But it's getting very difficult because for 11 and a half years, I've lived like a gypsy, and it's been really rough. And tomorrow, as we speak, the last of my possessions, which are only possessions, are going up to auction. So I really have nothing left of my life, really, in a way. But I'm glad I'm here. I'm still breathing and alive.
I'm sorry, really sorry to hear about, what had happened to you. We're here to try to compensate you for the losses that we can.
Yes.
We'll do everything in our power to do that. Are you registered?
No, but I will.
Register with us. Get a lawyer.
It's
complicated and it's unfortunate, but you may have a situation that needs a lawyer to help you get through all of the complications.
Exactly.
Because some of the things we are capable of compensating for you for, and some we can't.
Okay.
And we want to do as much as we can for you.
And I have workman's compensation that I went through all of that because of the 9/11.
Yeah. I'm sorry to hear that, but do register. Okay. Get this going so we can help you.
Thank you.
Again, the registration process is simple. It only takes a few minutes if you spoke with someone earlier today in a similar situation. If you don't have an attorney, you're thinking about getting an attorney and you're looking around, in the meantime, just register.
Okay.
You could get your attorney after you register.
I had a bad experience with my attorney during
the just register. If you have any questions about the registration process, call the help.
We're gonna take any questions. If you have additional questions, come on up afterwards, and we'll be happy to answer them. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for staying, and thank you for applying. Please apply. Okay? Thank you.